when your message is more important than you, that's when it'll all start to make sense.
Hi, this is Jay Abraham, and I'm thrilled today because we're going to interview somebody that I am deeply in his debt, but I also am a great, great, great fan, and I'm going to plumb and penetrate the mind and the methods of a really, really talented gentleman. Nick Nanton is a multi-Emmy award-winning producer. He does documentaries. He's done them on some very iconic people. And he's gotten into a lot of very noble causes. And we're going to explore two things. One, the power of documentaries strategically used for goals, for economic, for competitive, for business purposes, and why most people trying to do video marketing miss the mark horribly. And we'll probably introduce you today to a whole new world of possibility that somebody like Nick may or may not be able to help you with, but it will change your posture of, or your posture and perspective, let me say that, of what to do with your brand to elevate and accelerate its preemptive posture in your marketplace. Nick, thank you.
Thanks for having me.
What a pleasure. So with full disclosure, I have no economic interest in this interview, but I do have a noble debt of gratitude because you produced an exceptional documentary on me that I never got to see until you released it. You got people like Tony Robbins and Dave Asprey and Damon John all to be on it. You integrated a lot of footage from lots of parts of my past in a masterful way, and everybody who's seen it has been impressed. And even my wife is impressed with me and my family, and they go, oh, really? Wow. I didn't know that about you, so I thank you.
My pleasure.
And everybody that sees it gains a elevated respect for me, and that helps my brand. So thank you. So let's start with your motivation to get into this field in the first place. Sometime in the past, there's Nick Nanton doing something else. You are an attorney by profession. What got you into the whole field of wanting to be a serious documentary maker?
My business partner, Jack, and I, who you know, built what became and still is the largest personal branding agency in the world. Okay. And what I found fascinating is that while many of the people we'd work with would be a really successful dentist from New Jersey or a personal injury lawyer from Texas or whatever, and most people just sort of pass those people by as a person in the marketplace. But what I learned, because my job was to help them position and grow in the market, whether it was local, regional, national, worldwide, globally, was that everyone has an interesting story. And so some more interesting than others, but what the real difference that I learned about, in this case, it was a branding business, right?
Right.
The way that I really was able to distill it after a decade of doing it is that your brand is simply your story. And so people will try to charge you as much money as you will relinquish to build a brand, to use logos, colors, look and feel. And I'm not saying any of that's unimportant, but I think most of them don't start in the center of it all. Because your brand is your story. Branding is simply storytelling. When you tell your story correctly, you become the most uniquely positioned person in the world to solve the problem of your ideal client. And then finally, a great brand is nothing more than a story that your clients and prospects want to retell for you and bring people back to you.
I love that.
Thank you. So when I saw that, when I sort of distilled all that, I said, man, if I could tell these stories of people there's so many people who got into plastic surgery because their parents died in a house fire and they got deformed and they were able to get their life back. I've seen people who do dentistry who people get a job and they couldn't get a job before because their mouth looked funny, right?
Yes.
And so there's all these human stories at the heart of what they do, and I was hearing them and they were impacting me, but I knew that they weren't telling these stories effectively in the marketplace. So I really started with saying, my job is to help you tell your story effectively in the marketplace. How can I take that story and remove you from the equation so you can't screw it up and tell it for you? So that's sort of how I got into it.
That's fabulous. And just for reference credibility, why don't you share some of the, you've been nominated how many times for an Emmy?
Well, now I'm just, I just got 11 more. So now 37 Emmy nominations, and I've lost more than I've won. I'll put it that way. But I've won 11 so far. Hopefully this this next round of, my team got 11, I got 8. Hopefully we'll get a few more.
Are they sitting in your office?
They are, yes. Yeah.
They got to be impressive.
They're fun.
That's good. Very, very impressive. So tell us about some of the really noteworthy documentaries you've made to date.
So I've done really, I would say, sort of two sides of the coin, because my love for business and entrepreneurship will never die.
Right.
Selfishly, most of the entrepreneurial documentaries I've done, I did them because I wanted to spend more time with the person. So of course I did yours, I did one for Joe Polish, I did one on Jack Canfield of Chicken Soup for the Soul, Brian Tracy. And so I went from that and then started doing business icons. I have a series now called In Case You Didn't Know on Amazon.
All right.
And Larry King's the executive producer.
All right.
And I started out by doing Larry's story.
All right.
And he loved it and he decided to join me on the quest. And then the format of the show is to show you to use storytelling as a medium to show you someone you know, but you don't know everything about them, and then someone who you don't know, but you should know. So first episode is Larry. Second episode is my best friend who you know, Rami Romani, my cinematographer, fled Egypt in the revolution, became world-famous director, and he and I are best friends. And then my third episode is coming out of Maria Menounos, the TV host, who fought brain cancer. Fourth one is Nita Cobain, who you would know.
Yes.
But I've got Anthony Scaramucci, I've got Glenn Beck coming up, I've got Lisa Nichols from The Secret, I've got Peter Diamandis, I've got Dean Kamen. And so I sort of moved into sort of the business icon world. So that's sort of the entrepreneurial self-help, because I believe that everyone has a story that you can learn from. The other side I do is nonprofit stuff. And so I've been super blessed to do some amazing stories. Just finished up one on Folds of Honor. Folds of Honor has given $120 million in scholarships to the families of fallen soldiers.
Wow.
So if you met any soldier on the front line before they were killed, they would say, take care of my family. And that's literally what they're doing. People say, oh, there's lots of college scholarships. They start from grade school. If you need help with therapy, whatever. So, amazing organization.
That's wonderful.
Did one on Canines for Warriors. They help wounded warriors with PTSD or suicidal to gain a canine companion that helps them live life again. And I'll tell you, just to give context to that, because we all hear about PTSD and suicide, the thing that I didn't realize before I got into that, the suicide rate is actually for one cause that I wouldn't have assumed it was. It was because you're so debilitated from flashbacks and PTSD that you actually have tortured your mind into thinking that if you would just leave the earth, your family would be better off. Right, because you can't go out into public, you can't.
That's horrible.
So it's amazing. So won some Emmys for that one. So I did that. I've done now three documentaries with Operation Underground Railroad, thanks to being introduced by Russell Brunson, where we've documented the raid and rescue of human trafficking survivors and children all across
the
globe. Everyone's story is so fascinating, and I'll say it because I often will forget. You mentioned earlier, like, the biggest mistake people make. The biggest mistake people make in storytelling. So if you come to me and say, hey, Nick, will you make a documentary on X organization?
Yes.
They try to make a story on the organization, and that's not the story. The story is always in the people. The story is really twofold. The people who started it and why they wanted to start it, and then the people they've helped, and how on the front lines of a customer or a client or a person they've helped, what has it done? What has this organization, this product, this service done in their everyday life to help them live a better life? And it's the people, stupid, and everyone misses that. It's literally the human stories. It just happens to be all tied around one common nucleus of a person or a product.
And you really and truly have a genius for building these documentaries, so they are not just engaging, but they are not just subliminally, but they are through all kinds of devices, graphics, cartoons, snippets from the past, current. You tell a story within a story. It's very, very impressive. And what I want to do, make sure in this interview that I give people a link to see just a spectrum of samples of the kind of really exceptional work you do. But let's talk a little bit right now about the strategic benefit that what I'll call it, a strategically crafted and a masterfully executed documentary can provide to your business, your career, your profession, your organization, your noble or your commercial agenda. So I'm throwing you like Rorschach. Your idea is to respond back or say, you can also say, Jay, maybe a good question, but a better might be this. This is all about trying to advocate for the viewer.
Thank you. It's a great question. I'll try to articulate it. If I could articulate it better, would be even better. But when you can show someone an emotional 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 90 minutes, whatever it is, an emotional portrait of a human being and why they really do what they do. When I cover a personal injury attorney. Now, for instance, I did one recently. Most people have a very interesting opinion of personal injury lawyers, right? Especially if you've never had to work with one.
You're right.
Right? That these guys are ambulance chasers or whatever. And there's scoundrels, rapscallions in every business.
Yes.
But the ones who are good at it, when you really, because I've dug in with them, because I've spent a lot of time with them, their days consist of speaking with people who've lost multiple family members. Like you don't get a check for $300,000. Typically, unless you've lost probably a child or two in the back of a car or in some horrific accident. And not only do you have to deal with that, you're dealing with the person on the other side who your job is to get that person the most you can possibly get. You can't replace the kids. You can't replace the spouse, the family. But maybe I can make their life a little more comfortable by the fact that they now can no longer walk or whatever it is by having some money to pay for the things they need. So not only do I have, if I'm the personal injury lawyer and you're my client, not only do I have to help you deal with the stuff in your life, I also have to be motivating you to fight as hard as you can when you really want to give up and just take some money or no money because it's too hard. This is a complex issue. So by humanizing the personal injury lawyer, showing these stories, and every one of these stories will make you cry. I mean, every single one, because if you, there's a concept in the world of storytelling called transportation. So if I'm reading your book, Jay, and you wrote whether it's a business book and you're telling me about when you met this guy, or it's a romance novel and you met the woman of your dreams, when you tell the story effectively, I'm gonna put myself in the shoes of whoever's first person I'm reading from. So if I can do that, and I can do that very effectively with a documentary, part of the problem with a lot of documentaries is they're talking heads. I have no emotional connection to anything happening.
Right.
When I can put you in the shoes of my protagonist, everything changes. You all of a sudden see a noble man or woman on a journey.
If you go back to my strategy of preeminence, it's that you want basically people to see you as a leader of a crusade.
Yeah.
They're on a mission, and you're on a mission, excuse me, and they're part of it.
Yes.
And they see that you have their best interest first and foremost at heart. And you're very, very gifted in being able to personify that in your work. And I think that's very important for me, just to slow down enough to recognize and articulate a little bit different. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. So there's a scientific research has been done that if I tell you my story effectively, the brain fires when you put yourself in my shoes. The brain fires many of the same chemicals and neuroscience. I'm not a neuroscientist, but basically that as if I were as if it were happening to me. And we've all been through a movie where we just cry.
Yes, you're
ferociously.
Right.
And so the interesting thing about it is, if you tell your story emotionally and effectively, two things. The viewer ends up feeling like they were a part of your story and a part of helping you get to where you are. So actually, subconsciously, if they were to go hire your competition or not work with you, they would all almost feel like they were tearing down something they helped to build up, which would be counterproductive to what human nature wants to do, which is really interesting.
Second of all, it makes sense.
It does, right. Second of all, if I put you in a room, so if I have a documentary that's been made on you, we did this. We put you in a room with a bunch of people to watch the documentary together.
Yes.
It's a shared experience. So they now all have bonded emotionally over not even talking, but it would be like if you and I were in a hostage crisis, thankfully we're not.
Yes.
Like, assuming we made it out of that, forever after we would have this forever bond of we made it through this together. Well, it's not quite a hostage crisis, but there's an emotional bond formed with the audience of like, I was there when they launched Jay's documentary. I was part of seeing it for the first time. Or if you have your own business and you, I have a used car dealer we did a doc on, an amazing family story of how he took over and grew his family's business and how he helps a lot of people and the community, is a man of the community. He hosted a premiere in his hometown and he filled it up with mostly friends and family, and then he had like 30 seats left, so he put them out to the public, invited the mayor, everyone comes, and then everyone, he's a hometown hero because everyone now really knows his story, and he's a guy uplifting the community, but everyone who was invited in, they're now part of the journey, and he's their guy, so anybody who wants, you know, a nicer, newer car in their community takes him to this guy because he's the guy that they've been on the journey with.
Yeah, I think that's brilliant. And one of the things that I think you do very masterfully is take someone who has probably more value, more contribution, more worth to a segment of a market, and you dimensionalize them, you humanize them, and you contextualize them in a way that their market can really appreciate more their distinction, their unique value, and the most importantly, the benefit they represent so uniquely to the audience. And I think people don't realize you can probably do that better video than you could in any other form, don't you think?
I absolutely think so. And let me tell you a few ways that I think everyone else gets it wrong.
Please.
So for instance, when I come in, so I did a spoken event recently and I had not planned to do it, but I got some questions and said, you know, I'm gonna just do a presentation I've never done before. It's not a presentation, I'm just gonna share it with you. The theme that keeps coming up over and over again in my films and interviews, people will say one thing, I've never said this before on camera. And so I found that fascinating that people were like, well, why me? You just met me or whatever. Yes. And so I realized there was a series of things that I was doing that were getting people to actually share their sort of their true heart, their true connection, their true story.
They were being vulnerable.
They were being vulnerable. And human connection, you can't beat it. It's the best thing on earth, right?
I agree.
And so what I realized that most, if you bring a camera crew into most places, and you've worked with my crew multiple times, they'll do multiple things. Number one, unfortunately, most people in the entertainment business are never taught that it's not about them. So the guy who comes in with the camera, the producer, the director, they're celebrities in their own right. And most of the time, they come into a room, bring their own energy, and basically let you know that you're privileged, that they're there. That's just sort of how it happens. So for me, before I even get in the room before, there's a couple things I do. I let my subject know, hey, look, I'm here to tell your story, it's not about me. Number two, when we go into anyone's house, whether it's a testimonial we're shooting or Larry King's office, we say, hey, look, I tell my crew, look, first of all, the most important person in the room is the person I'm interviewing, and everything we do, we orchestrate around them, not around us. So if there's an angle they're uncomfortable with, even if it's your best angle, we're going to kill it. We're going to make sure that anything we move, before we move anything, we say, is it okay to move things? And by the way, if you need to, take pictures of where it was, because when we leave, it better be like we were never there. And what I want to happen and what does happen is when the next time someone asks them to do an interview or shoot or whatever, they all, because I hear it, they tell me, it's like, I wish Nick's crew was here. They made this so much easier. And it's all about—
And I would agree, because it was a pleasure, a joy, and they basically subordinated themselves to the betterment of the outcome of the group. And the documentary.
And that is the thing everyone forgets, because by nature, people in film are trained to make sure that whatever the best angle is, you better have it, because your job is a cinematographer.
Yes.
Well, that is your job until I tell you that job is not nearly as important as letting me. We've all seen the crappiest cell phone camera footage ever that goes viral and gets 37 million views because they didn't interfere with the story.
Right.
And so our job is to make sure that we're not interfering with the story. And so just, there's a bunch of other things I could tell you, but that's huge
very
one.
Impressive. Yeah.
Another one is not having camera angles that connect you with the subject. So getting close enough and tight enough to where on an angle where you feel like you're in the conversation. Another quick one would be not asking people to speak into the camera, because most people are terrible at that. It's a hard skill to learn.
It is.
But inviting people, having the camera just over like my shoulder, to where people psychologically say, I've been invited into the conversation, but no one's accosting me. It's like a cocktail party. I can nudge into the conversation, yes, and just listen, or I can not. But I'm not expected to respond or be prepared. And so there's a lot of just simple devices we use, of course. And my team is world class. That's why it works.
Yeah,
everyone who I ever bring into a room, you want to be friends with.
Yes.
And then my editor, my everyone just is the best at what they do.
And you have passion. I mean, I find that many providers of services that are designed to enhance the success or the credibility or the sellability of a certain kind of a business or of an individual, they're apathetic. They don't even enjoy their professional job. You have a passion and you have a purpose, and you see all kinds of unique possibilities in the clients you serve that they don't see themselves. And you're able to really manifest for them, I believe, outcomes and connectivity with their market and dimensionality and humanity and authenticity for them that they can't even express on their own.
Well, it's interesting because the great perspective in this, I've done it for you. And one of the things that you kept asking me, are you sure you have enough? And the real question that most people ask is, are you sure my story is worth telling? I mean, that's really what, at some level, everyone's asking, right? And so the funniest thing about our story is it's truly the only thing we have at the end. Like when you go to
die. And we all have a story.
It's all you have. I mean, the only thing
and
you can take with
you. And most people don't know it, and they can't appreciate it.
Because they lived it. Look, and so the funny thing about it is you've been in situations. Look, we all appreciate when others appreciate us or revere us, and we've all worked hard to gain stature and preeminence. But I mean, but at the end of the day, the good news is neither of us believe our own hype. That's why we can do what we do.
Yeah, we've got humility.
Right, exactly. And so the beauty of it is most people do. We're all born into this world with, as Dan Sullivan called it, unique ability, right?
Yes.
With this thing that you're so celebrated until you're 5 years old and they put you in school.
Yes.
And then the teacher, you know, as my friend Alex Sharfin says, you know, one warden, 50 prisoners doesn't work. So, but they got to put you in these boxes.
Yes,
and so
yes.
They sort of beat this originality out of you till you're 18, 22, or 25, depending on how far you go into school. You borrow a bunch of money, and so you work from 25 to 65 to gain your freedom back. So from 65 to when you die, you can become who you were from 0 to 5, right?
That's great.
I mean, it's Dan Sullivan's analogy, but it's so true. And so what people, we're born sort of with this light, this thing we're supposed to do. And unfortunately, we get a bunch of, I'll call them screen doors in our life that sort of keep dawning this light. And what I do is I just try to go with my clients and say, hey, tell me your story and let me look at the good, the bad, and the ugly. That it's really interesting. If you take a moment to write down, you could divide it however you want, but let's say let's say you're 40 years old.
Okay.
So take it your life in decades and write down, even just start, the three most important things you remember the best from 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40. The good, the bad, and the ugly. Maybe one good, one bad, one ugly. You've probably tried to repress all the bad and the ugly, and you've probably tried to strengthen the good, which is totally
human nature. Yeah.
However, some of the most important lessons of who you are and why you do what you do are caught in the bad and the ugly, and everyone wants to forget that. And those are things that sort of dull that light. So if you can work through those things, what a therapist would have you do, by the way,
yes.
If you can work through those things and realize the value of them and how it makes you way more unique and way more, as our friend Dan Kennedy would call, dog whistles.
Yes.
If you've been through a divorce and you talk about divorce, people who've been through a divorce go, that's my guy or that's my lady. If you haven't, you just let, okay, yeah, not for me. But so the more you can get into those vulnerabilities,
yes,
those bads and those uglies, it actually informs why you're so passionate about helping the people you help.
That's great. So one of the things that I always do when I work with a client privately is I instill and install a strategy of preeminence. Many of them, because I self-select, or they almost help me, already possess a level of preeminence, but they haven't taken it full circle. And one of the first things I do is have them tell their story, their origin story, what got them there, their belief, how they really look at their role, what they're trying to do. Because most of them transcend making money. They got into it for a purpose,
right,
and a passion, and they really have an empathic love, respect for their market, their clients, their prospects, their team, their industry, and it's not expressed. And just expressing it internally, it animates and it elevates and it accelerates the collaboration with your team. But expressing it to the marketplace is almost like one of those humongous electromagnets they use in the scrap to pick up the whole car. It just attracts people, and it's a tragedy and a travesty. Most people don't get to do that. Let's talk about some of—
Well, it invites the market to collaborate with you.
Yeah, because they feel like, hey, this guy or this woman or this company or these people, they're real. And you can introduce your team, but most people, when they introduce their team, it's, pictures, instead of showing them and introducing them and having them be real, a little bit awkward,
Who they
human,
are.
You know, flawed.
Right.
Because none of us are perfect. No. Anybody who tries to depict omnipotence, or perfection is, you know, they're hypocritical. So let's talk about two things that are sort of parallel universes. Help us, because I'm hoping I can drive people for their own benefit, irrespective if they ever become your clients, to see some samples or examples or full-on watch some of the documentaries you've made, because they will see, they'll be impacted. But I would like you to give them a 3D lens so they can see dimensionally why they are impacted. And the way to do it is explain two things. Some of the documentaries that you had to nuance strategically to get the outcome you wanted, and what they will see that really grabs them or grips them about it, besides what we just talked about as far as cinematography or or directorial, but what you embedded in it ethically that is so different, and what you had to do to be the advocate of the client or the company you were doing the cause, and what people will see when they view samples or the whole thing, and why that is so powerful, and why they're missing the boat by not at least exploring having that for themselves.
Sure. So the best place to find them, if you just go to Amazon, I have a ton of stuff on Amazon Prime, so you can watch for free.
And would I put your name in?
Just if you go to Amazon, put Nick Nanton Prime Video.
How many are there?
Dozen or more, probably. So,
okay.
Operation Toussaint, our first human trafficking film in Haiti, is on there. The documentary I did on Rudy, if you've ever seen the movie Rudy, I did the doc on Rudy. Jack Canfield is up there, Brian Tracy, Canines for Warriors, a lot.
Okay.
The thing that, the common thread of what I learned probably the hard way is when I go in to tell someone's story, I used to, so if I was doing a podcast, an interview, or whatever, so same skill set as doing an interview from behind the camera, my unique ability, again, to borrow from Dan Sullivan, is not reading, research, and preparation. Not my thing. My unique ability is having great conversations, which is very well served by this style of thing. So I've learned if it doesn't start or end with a great conversation, I'm out. Okay. Just not, and I have, but I realize that doesn't mean I can be unprepared. So, but what do is I have writers who love research and writing. So I have them prepare the outline of a story, because the documentary, you can't script it. You can outline it. And then the mistake that I made was during an interview, I would have, let's say, 40 points that I want to cover, because this is the story I've outlined. Well, I used to try to keep steering the interviewee back to my 40 points so I could get what I know. But what I really learned, and what you'll see in all these films, is the only story you can really tell effectively is the story that's really there, number one, and the story that that the subject is interested in. You'll see a passion in all my documentaries of the interviewee, the people on camera. And it's because I learned I can ask all the questions I want, but and you know from doing interviews, when someone lights up about something, just go down that rabbit hole, because that's what they're really passionate about. So oftentimes I went to tell this story, I ended up telling a different story completely, because you know a lot of stuff about Rudy's life because you've seen the movie. What you don't know is that it took him 10 years to get that movie made. What you don't know is that Notre Dame told him, if you come on campus one more time and mention the word movie, you're going to be banned from campus for life. These are things you don't know.
Yeah.
And so these are things that, I mean, for Rudy, it was festering in him for 20 years to talk about this stuff. So let's talk about it. And so going down the road of taking it, and this is a bad analogy because I'm not nearly a sculptor, but you start with this piece of rock, and all you can do is remove the BS and see what's really there.
That's a great graphic. It's a great imagery. So share with me some of your work, and explain to the viewer how it transformed or supported or dimensionalized or expanded the success, the positioning, I guess I just want you to tell some success stories about how this helped the organization or the individual and how they applied it and used it. You talked about bringing a group together for the premier, and I could see that that would be a very great rallying, elevating them, their stature, making them human, telling their story. We've already covered that, but give me some more. I want to dredge and draw out of you every piece of perspective you may never have talked about.
Perfect. So very simply, with a nonprofit, for instance, most people who even support nonprofits well are not great at telling the story of the nonprofit. So the documentary removes that burden. So people can host wine parties, wine and cheese, dinners, and even at their home with five people on a couch can share the mission of the nonprofit and get donors and people connected with the nonprofit. All the way up to Russell Brunson has held two premieres for Operation Underground Railroad, raised $1 million each premiere in a big room because people got
emotionally involved. $1 million helped. He contributed to the organization.
So in each case, he and his business partner, Todd, matched the donation from the audience. Okay. And so $500,000, and became $1 million, went straight to the nonprofit to rescue kids around the world from being sex trafficked. So that's on the large scale. But so the small could be now everyone who loves that nonprofit. So that that documentary, Operation Two Saints, on Amazon, it makes you at the... Tony Robbins at the end of the movie makes you want to just throw money at the screen. Take my money.
Yes.
But they invite you, that nonprofit, they invite you to become an abolitionist to help end slavery. And you can do that for as little as $5 or $10 a month.
Yes.
And so it's an invitation into that. That's a nonprofit format that works great. And then I have one other nonprofit that has chapters around the country. They're about to do a premiere, and all the chapters use as a fundraiser in 50 chapters
they
around
do,
the country.
They do premieres in every city.
Very simple. Another thing that I learned, by the way, about movies, I wanted to get them out as quickly as possible. I've learned now that it's a way more intimate thing to, you can maybe run for two, three, you could run for 5 years probably in private screenings and say, hey, this isn't out yet.
Yeah.
I want you to come join me for this private screening. I have one financial advisor example. A lot of financial advisors do seminars, dinner seminars, other things.
Yeah, sure.
This financial advisor had a medical emergency. I was going to cancel a seminar that night. I said, don't cancel the seminar, run the documentary.
Yes.
He played the documentary for the audience and he got 90% of the same close ratio for appointments that he got as if he was in person. Now, that's a big deal.
That is very powerful.
Because you can scale around the country, invite people to a special red carpet screening, and you can have one office that services everybody, but you can have infinite amount of screening. So that's another
And you could also, if you understand strategic alliances, you can get other organizations, influencers, to invite their people to a private screening.
Yes, so that's a model. Another model is, for instance, with a personal injury lawyer. Now, when you are going to try to get a personal injury case, let's say the ethical way, so someone loses a family member, bad accident, whatever, they refer you in, right?
Right.
Well, the bigger the case, the more people are going to try to help them refer them, and you're going to play against sharks too, right?
That's true.
So you have everything from people doing things they're not allowed to do to things they are allowed to do. But at the end of the day, let's look at from the point of view of the client.
Yes.
You've got a very distressed person who now all of a sudden their husband's never coming home, their wife's never, whatever's happened, and they're not only lost emotionally, they could be lost financially in other ways. Well, one of the strategies there is for the ethical lawyer to say, hey, look, I know I can't possibly imagine what you're going through. The good news is I've walked a lot of people in your shoes through this phase of their life and helped them get out to better on the other side. Now, I know you have a lot to figure out, but you have to figure some things out or else nothing's going to happen. So here's the deal. You're going to be surrounded by friends and family the next few days, and you're going to have to make some hard decisions. All I would ask is that when you're with those friends and family, watch this documentary with them so you can see why I do what I do. And if I'm not for you, you'll know instantly. But if I am and you connect with me, I would love to help you. Now, that's a very, very, very different pitch than all the other sharks that are coming at it, right?
That's great. Well, I mean, just in my own experience, when people now are curious, not apprehensive, but I'm very expensive and my proposition is very unique, all we do is say, watch this documentary. I mean, relative to where you are in the cosmos, I mean, you've been able to secure for me Tony Robbins, Damon John, Dave Asprey, the world's top expert on Six Sigma, clients, footage. It's so credible. It's so credible that it totally eliminates apprehension. It totally establishes total trust, comfort. You know, they may not be able to afford my rates.
Right.
They may not like my style, but there's no question when you're done watching this that I'm the real thing. I know how to do it. I've done it over and over again. I can see opportunities and solve problems. And that was relegated to my salespeople's ability in the past. Now, all they have to do is say, look, why don't I send you a link to this documentary?
Right.
It's 47 minutes.
Right.
47 minutes. If you're even contemplating anything in your business that is worth any amount of improvement, will you invest 47 minutes? And
right.
You'll either gain understanding, appreciation, and a very broader sense of possibility, or you won't.
Yep. One of the things I think is incredible about this strategy, which I haven't found someone willing to test it yet, but I know it'll work, any sort of distributed sales force, so that could be everything from a franchisee to a licensee. If I can make a film...
Or network marketers.
Yeah, if I can make a film on the main concept and why it works and why the founders believe in it, because you're an extension of them, then all you have to do is say, hey, look, watch this movie, and if you're interested in what this has to say, I am your conduit to the answers in this movie.
And here's the thing that I think you offer that localized or what I'll call, not hack, because I don't want to demean people, but less strategic and less elevated thinkers don't, is when you create it with total honesty and truth, it is a Hollywood-worthy documentary, whether it ever is publicly released or not, or just kept internally by the organization or the individual to use for his or her or their business or causal betterment is their choice.
Right.
But you're creating, I mean, the documentary you created for me, we could put on Amazon, we could put, and I think it would be very, very equivalent of a lot of the documentaries. So you're not creating a schlock piece. This has enormous value, but then there's a secondary value. You can cut segments out and use them because you end up giving people so many different slices and dices of commentary. You get people to express in words and mental imagery outrageous elements of the value that your client, the company retaining you, has the ability to create for them. And again, the key to any kind of business, causal is the same thing. It's either solving a problem, making an opportunity available and realized, or it is in making life more enjoyable. And if you can express whatever, basically the benefit, the advantage, that's marketing 101. If you can personify, present, demonstrate, denominate that in ways that the client himself, herself, or themselves can't, you've given them such a monumental boost and advantage. And I think that most people don't even grasp the magnitude and all the ways you can use it. What are just some of the different industries or applications that you have applied this to in the past that are very interesting?
The one that I love, so when you're trying to persuade anyone that you are the right provider for them, the right solution, whether that be a hospital system, they have their own ways of advertising, a doctor, a financial advisor, you're trying to show them that ideally, oh, I know what you need, and even better, I've already done this before successfully, and here's the outcome. That's what you would show if you could. So one of the things I always try to do is try to find sort of some avatars of what, let's say, your top three or five types of clients would be, and weave those into the film, but then also edit those separately. So when your sales team, you know what, Mrs. Smith, you're just like Mrs. Jones. We just helped her. You know, I'm going to send you a 3 to 5 minute clip from a documentary that an Emmy Award-winning director came in and did on us. And I'll call you back afterwards because you'll see we can help you. And so within that, you have so many devices you can use. You have, you know, emotion and showing how they got back their life or whatever it is.
Yes.
And so we've done that. I've used it in the health space, certainly, and because, you know, people who are experiencing health problems, particularly things like pain that are just really hard to quantify, and how that might work, and showing the difference in someone's life, even if they're skeptical, after they had a certain treatment or decided to make a certain decision in their life, it helps people to see that there is. At the end of the day, I think maybe people don't make decisions because they're not sure it'll work for them, or they're not sure what's on the other side of this wall. Sometimes the devil we know is better than the devil we don't, right? And so showing people who've come out the other side of something, particularly the harder or more tragic it is an amazing device to help people who are scared of making a decision, to make a decision that could truly impact their life. But until they've seen that someone else made it out alive in a better position, they have a hard time with it.
So I'm going to do a little bit of a fun little game with you. I just was at a Clippers game, and at the halftime, they offered somebody a prize if he could name at least 10 or 15 different movies that were thematically basketball. The guys go, blah, blah, blah. I would like you to name in a minute or two as many different industries and applications as you can remember you've helped.
Okay. Done. Financial advisors. We have done hedge fund managers. We have done people in the private space technology community, chiropractors, stem cell doctors, thyroid and hormone replacement specialists, certainly business consultants, motivational speakers, universities.
Technologists?
Certainly technologists. Health and well, like fitness professionals, done that.
Right. Yes, all and you've done all kinds of causes. Yeah. That's enough. Yeah. Point is that literally the applicability, if the organization, entity, individual, professional, or the company is right, is profound. I want to make another point. There's a big difference between an Emmy award-winning documentary and a schlocky infomercial. Totally different. I mean, it's night and day different. The credibility, the quality, the advocacy, the showcase of presenting you, your organization, your work, your purpose, the possibilities you represent to the audience, totally different. It's the credibility and the usability and all the different ways you can apply it. So what would you say, and this interview was at my bequest, not Nick's. He had no idea what I was going to ask him. I am so impressed and really fascinated by the power. I should make one point that I forgot. Just show somebody the enormous catalytic value and impact and implication that the right documentary can mean to a career, a business, a professional. Most everybody is aware of Tony Robbins. He was successful before they did his documentary, and he would get 1,500 people to one of his events. Post documentary, he gets 15,000 people. I'm talking about a zero on the end. Post-documentary, he gets 6,000 people to his date with destiny. Post-documentary, he gets 2,500 people to his $10,000 business mastery. Post-documentary, he gets 800 people to become $85,000 and $150,000 Platts and Lyons. It's not just that, but his stature was elevated and expanded and differentiated at such a profound level. And that's on a relative basis, no matter if you're smaller, if the application is different. That is the kind of source and force of exponential, explosive growth and credibility that can be achieved very rapidly, don't you think?
It absolutely can. It's just all about, look, in all these types of things, this is a form of media. It's a medium for sharing your story. And at the end of the day, how you strategically implement it into the process of converting someone into a raving fan is really where all the rubber meets the road.
But I also think that most people don't understand, this is, in my opinion, the ultimate vehicle for establishing preemptive credibility and trust in a marketplace that is far too busy with mediocre or under underperforming competitors.
I think that, yes, people get used to same old same, and it doesn't have to be that way, obviously.
Good. So in conclusion, I've tried to ask you a myriad of cool questions that I hope helped you express who you are, what you are, and what you do, and why it's so relevant to every specter that can use it. But also, you know, because you live this day in, day out, you do it for different people, you propose the applications and implications to people that you see that they don't. What's one either question I should have asked you and didn't, or one concluding perspective that you want to make sure is understood by the viewer, irrespective of whether you ever have the ability or the privilege of doing their documentary, just so they should know about what you do and what it can do for them?
So I would say one thing, I think a big mental block that a lot of people have in many facets of marketing themselves, their business, everything else, is that should I be the one doing this, or shouldn't, if I was worth doing this for, wouldn't someone else be doing it? Wouldn't a big news story come about, or these sorts of questions, right? And so what I tell people is, look, first of all, typically, unless it's a negative news story, people aren't clamoring at your doors to do this.
You're right.
And the thing you need to pay attention to is, the thing I think you should focus on is, when what you can do for others, when you're as convicted as you should be about it, that it's really about what you can do for them, you'll get out of your own way, and you do everything you can to share that story to just help more people. So when you get to that point, is when you'll stop asking the wrong questions, and then you'll start asking the right question of, what do I need to do to get this message to the most people? And I just encourage people to work through whatever insecurities they have, whatever things maybe aren't working in their business or life, in order to get them to the point of when they realize that their message is more important than them. That's when you call someone like me, or you start sharing that message more. And I see it with people who are interested in public speaking, but I want to lose 50 pounds. Look, when your message is more important than you, that's when it'll all start to make sense.
It's beautifully stated. Nick Nanton, 11-time Emmy Award winning, not nominated, 37-time nominated, 11-time award winning, masterful strategic documentary producer and supreme advocate for the betterment of his client, whether they be entrepreneurs, whether they be professionals, whether they be nonprofits. I appreciate it. How would someone get in touch with you if they're so inclined?
I'm not hard to find. Nick Nanton, as long as you spell it right, I've got all those social handles and everything else. NickNanton.com is a great way. There's a
contact form. N-A-N-T-O-N.
N-A-N-T-O-N, yep.
All right, I appreciate it very much, and I respect and am grateful for what you've done for me with my documentary. And as a courtesy, we're going to put a link to mine on here so you can see the quality and how compelling his ability is to really bring somebody dimensionally far, far more powerfully connected to the market they're trying to serve. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I appreciate it.